Manic Street Preachers, and they're here for a work in progress. James and Nikki, nice to see you. Welcome to 1FM.
How are you doing?
You're smiling a lot, you two. You seem very proud of yourselves. That's the first, that's a little taster of the new album there. And from what you were saying just before we started this conversation on the air, you're very, very happy with it.
Yes.
we always delude ourselves. But we are particularly happy at this moment.
We didn't delude yourselves with the last record. I mean, it did a good job for you, didn't it?
Yeah, in the terms that we were talking, I couldn't help but kind of like, you know, miss the target, so to speak. Mm. Because we set ourselves high targets. So some people think we've eaten a lot of humble pie since. Could be true.
What did you learn from Generation Terrorists that you put to work on this new album?
Just not to be ashamed of being a band anymore. So kind of like we were kind of like, to a certain degree, we tamed our band sound to a certain degree.
What, for the last album?
Yeah, to a certain degree, and perhaps not to be so scared of, like, you know, of doing otherwise, this one.
Yeah. Well, I suppose, I mean, because I listened to this album only once, and that was today. I got a cassette very late last night and listened to it this morning, and it did sound that there are some elements of more edginess, but there are still one or two songs which sound a bit more like, you know, like maybe Motorcycle Emptiness, that kind of rock ballad sort of thing. Yeah. So you haven't totally lost the smooth edge.
Yeah,
no. We'll always go out of our way, you know. We're real fans of pop music and rock music throughout history, so we're always going to go out of their way to make something which we think is really commercial.
Yeah.
To please ourselves, not to please other people, but, you know.
It certainly would please the record company, however, if you made something commercial. And I think that, you know, this is going to sell because it's a good record.
Yeah, I mean, that's the bottom line. Lyrically and musically, it's a lot more nasty than Generation Terrorist. Lyrics are much more powerful and music goes with it. It's just more of a band. It's our first proper album, you know. Generation Terrorist was a total statement of the 20 years of our life, you know, total hatred.
This time around we just followed our muse a tiny bit more.
Is all the stuff on the new album completely new?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Absolutely?
Yeah. No old songs at all.
No, every song was written and rehearsed within, and recorded within an 8-month period, basically.
Where did you record this album?
Outside recording studios in Surrey, so really nice.
That's not the place you recorded the first album?
No.
Where did you do the first album?
Blackburn. Little tip, that was.
Ripley in Surrey.
Yeah. What is it about Surrey?
It's all these horrible, stuck-up English people who make you nice and angry when you record it.
All right, okay, so you go around the local village, you just work out some anger and then go and record it. And the subject matter on this album then is different from the last album, would you say?
Just a continuation, you know, in total, you know, anger and depression, the usual sort of Manic Street Preachers themes, but I think we've just articulated it in a much better way.
Yes, yeah, a bit of a concurrent theme of just loss of innocence as well, just the nature of being in a band, you know, kind of like you just forget how to use your original language that you were born with, and also there's certain things that kind of we're used to a new bourgeoisie now, you know, kind of like, and that's kind of like, you know, certain people that we know in our industry, which is sickness as well. So so many, just many more targets that we can aim at as well, just because we've been in a band for 2 years.
Mm. Okay, now listen, we played you the first single from it, and this next one is the French one that I can't pronounce.
This is Van Gogh's last words. When he wrote a suicide note, he actually wrote La tristesse durera, and it means the misery will never end, or the sadness will never go away.
See, I often wonder how a band can come up with something like that. I mean, did you do a lot of work to get that quote, or did you just know it anyway? Are you that knowledgeable and articulate, or whatever?
No, it's just my brother. He's really a knowledgeable bloke, and he just passed it on.
Okay,
and it seemed to fit it perfectly.
Let's hear the song. Okay, that's a French song, La tristesse durera. I didn't do French at school, is that right?
La tristesse durera.
There we are then. See, I didn't do French at school, I did German, you see, not being in any way romantic at all. And I can't even speak the rest of them in German now. All right, so you're going to go out on tour again. You've done a few live things with us. And in fact, you did a roadshow with us last year for Your Sins. Actually, it was great fun.
It was, all the way to Great Yarmouth for 3 minutes of pop mayhem.
Yeah. And so you're back out on tour in July.
Yeah.
Looking forward to it?
Yeah, we love being on the road.
The only time I ever feel like I've got a proper job, that's all. I feel like a wage earner.
Do you think you've learned anything? I should really just ask you about this. So, you know, the Michael Stipe thing, which was very well reported and which you got a severe beating for. Have you learned anything after that episode as a band?
Just, you know, trivialities in the media can be blown up into huge things, I suppose. You know, there's much worse things going on. It's just a natural part of the way we are to say horrible things, you know. Me and Richie said much worse things in our time, and it's just the way it is, I suppose, you know.
Does it mean you won't say so many things about that particular subject in future?
Oh, I just think, you know, this album will say everything we've got to say, basically. You know, people look in the lyrics, they realise there's... I think, looking back historically, we've been really... Looking back at all working-class bands seem to have a lot more soul and a lot more history in them, from the Beatles through even to Happy Monday, Stone Roses, anything. Mm. And these days, the industry seems to be permeated by middle-class student bands who just don't take any risks musically or in any sort of way whatsoever. And that just sort of gives us a lot of hope, you know, that all the bands we ever thought are any good, we're all a lot like us. You know, they're always going to have huge mess-ups in their career.
Then the next song, I mean, Druggie, it's...
Druggie.
We know what you mean when you're talking about it then anyway, don't we? We know when you hear the title what the song is about.
Yeah, I mean, it's not anti-drugs, it's not pro-drug, it's just basically saying I'm sick to the death of at any festival or any rec company you go to and you get some real dickhead coming up to you going, do you want a spliff, man? You know, I just feel like punching their heads in. And it's just, whatever you do in the band, you're just full of dead heads.
You know, since you've been in the band, people just think that we haven't entered into kind of like the university of life just because we don't take drugs, you know. They think it's an education in itself, but it's not, you know, to us. It's just a frivolous way to spend your money. It's just obscene.
There is a lot of money to be made in the record business. I suppose that's why the record industry likes to keep control. I mean, they like to keep control over bands.
They like to keep you in debt. You know, the more money you pile up, unrecoupable, the happier they are.
Because then they know when it comes to the crunch and they want to bully you, they can bully you.
Yeah.
Except it didn't work with people like George Michael, one of your corporate label mates. Yeah.
I mean, the view we take is that a record label's there to be used, you know, just like another arm of being in a band, and therefore we don't have any problems with it. It's a bit pathetic when you get all these bands saying they'd be bullied by record companies. You know, when they're multi-millionaires, grow up a bit, I'd say.
In the time since Generation Terrorist, there've been I suppose the suede phenomenon has been the thing that has come and sort of and actually been very successful. Have you been impressed with what else has gone on, like the suede thing?
No, I think suede are fine in the sense that they're, you know, a very good pop band, but
are they the middle class?
To me, they represent, you know, too many sort of middle class art values, you know, pretensions of art, you know, the David Bowie school, which is fine, you know, they make good pop records like Mark Bolan or whatever, but it's not so exciting for me as a person. Perhaps I'm too old now.
The message that we wanted to get across from being in the band was not a kind of comment really on sexuality. You know, kind of we might have flirted with androgyny in the way we loved, yeah, but it never really entered the lyrics, and it's just not our area, man.
And what about the tour this time? Is it gonna are you gonna be doing stuff different, or are you just going straight out to rock and roll like you did the last time I saw you?
Yeah, I mean, it'll probably be a longer show, more songs to play. You know, we've got more
got
creature standards. And, you know, be playing bigger places, playing for longer. It'd be more like the E Street Band or something.
Barrowlands, Glasgow and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, I love playing live.
I thought, you know, when Motorcycle Emptiness was around, I thought that would be a fine song for, you know, a cover by, you know, some huge American rock artist.
That song has been covered by a couple of youth club bands.
That's all so far.
Nothing.
There are some songs on the new album which I think, you know, would lend themselves to that.
I think history will judge us in those terms, maybe in 10 years' time.
Well, I suppose it took a long time for Biggle to start covering U2 songs, so you have a bit of time yet, I suppose. Okay, let's play this track, Druggie, and thank you very much, both of you, for coming in. We'll look forward to the album in about a month and a bit's time, and the new single in a few weeks' time. Thank you very much. Thanks.